Blackstone Audio presents Citizen Keane, The Big Lies Behind the Big Eyes by Adam Parfrey and Cletus Nelson. Read by Bronson Pinchot. Preface, Adam Parfrey. Much of the material for this book came from a cover story I had written for the San Diego Reader, that city's weekly newspaper that published a good number of my feature articles, in addition to a column called L.A. that called out my love-hate for my hometown, Los Angeles. On a 1991 trip to San Diego to finish research for another article, in those dark pre-Google days, one discovered stories by actually talking to people and keeping one's eyes open in the physical world, I ran across an article in a regional throwaway about Walter Keane. Yes, Keane, Walter Keane, the supposed progenitor of garish big eye art, was alive and living in La Jolla, where he was promoting a self-published memoir that presented himself as an artist on the level of Michelangelo, and, stunningly, a victim to court verdicts, fraudulent journalists, and a vindictive, sex-mad ex-wife. Yes, here was a good story. On the phone, 80-year-old Keane tried to make friends with me in dirty old man style. We hardly spoke for 5 minutes before he asked whether I had a girlfriend. Then he urged me to describe her looks and then the frequency of our lovemaking. Before I was able to change the subject, he asked, "She doesn't complain about sucking you off, does she? That can be a real problem if she's not willing and eager. I had the best and can give you tips." What an odd bird, I thought, as Walter and I made plans to get together for an interview. But first, I made my way to a courthouse office building where I got dozens of pages of court documents Xeroxed. The originals are no longer available from court archives, but some of the juicier excerpts are repeated in this book. At home, I searched out a prized possession, a two-volume monograph of Keane art, one titled Walter Keane, the other Margaret Keane, both with cellophane overlays above the precious tipped-in color plates. Both volumes were also boxed into a slipcase, mimicking ostentatious, high-end art books. What a strange production this was, as it included the musings of some stuffy elitist wasp with three names. My girlfriend, who was a talented artist herself, told me how much she liked Margaret's paintings of depressed Modigliani-like young women. I had to agree, despite society's dismissal of Keane art as being the worst sort of sentimental claptrap. The more I met with Walter Keane, the stranger came the story. The manipulations were extravagant, and no former friend or ally would ever back up his claims. When I dug into all his various court cases against Margaret, Walter came forward with salacious and horrifying accusations about the sexual behavior of his ex-wife, a woman deeply committed to the Jehovah's Witness faith. I felt a bit sleazy when I read Walter's accusations about Margaret in a phone interview. Luckily for me, she reacted well enough to all this and chuckled. "Yes, that's the way he is," she remarked before we spoke at length about her trials and tribulations. A few weeks later, I received from Margaret a couple of Jehovah's Witness books with pleasant inscriptions inside. At the time I was writing this story, wild, figurative, lowbrow art started to get a lot of attention, both in Los Angeles art galleries like La Luz de Jesus, when it occupied the second floor of a building on Melrose Avenue, and the influential Helter Skelter exhibition at the L.A. Museum of Contemporary Art that featured, among others, the paintings of Robert Williams. Williams also became the father figure for a new magazine, Juxtapose, that promoted the new figurative art universe, damning those who rebuked its imaginative creations as kitsch or illustration. Not that Robert Williams loved big eye art, but the idea of hanging kitsch seemed cool once again, and collectors came out of the woodwork to purchase inexpensive big eye art iterations to hang in hip coffee houses, diners, hairdressing studios, and nightclubs. The creepier the kitsch factor, the better for the walls. All of which begs the question, what is kitsch exactly? Is it the cheap, mass-produced stuff one could have found in a blue-chip stamp catalog? Or is it the high-cost but intentionally low-brow work of mutual funds broker-turned artist Jeff Koons, who sells massive balloon dogs for tens of millions of dollars? What makes one worthless and the other immensely valuable? The remarkable Norwegian painter Odd Nerdrum wrote a book about the kitsch conundrum called, naturally, kitsch, more than art. Nerdrum's book wishes to resuscitate the word kitsch from the insult applied to artwork that offends the modernist or postmodernist sensibility. After hearing his beautiful oil paintings belittled with the K-word, Nerdrum made it his life goal to elevate kitsch from being an insult to a badge of honor. Without stating it overtly, Nerdrum's kitsch book pays homage to Keane art and his/her particular aesthetic. Modernism itself has become a tradition that has conquered the entire Western world. Institutions, critics, artists, and educated people are obliged to be open for the new. My concern is what modernism has pushed out as its other. In the same way that Christianity demonized its competitors, so too did modernism, and the rule of modernism's hell was christened kitsch, signifying the antithesis of modern art. Kitsch became the unified concept for all that was not intellectual and new, all that was conceived as brown, old-fashioned, sentimental, melodramatic, and pathetic. As the Austrian author and philosopher Hermann Broch put it in the 1930s, kitsch is the antichrist, stagnation, and death. We all know the gypsy girl and the little boy with a tear, the grandmother with a child on her lap and the fisherman with his pipe, the two silhouettes against a sunset, and not the least, the moose by the lake. All of this became a forbidden area for the tastes of the educated. The so-called simple and blind taste for this imagery stood in contrast to Marx, Freud, and the entire modern elite, who had been seeing through everything down to its smallest particle. Modernism must have died a bit when Walter Keane turned his marketing talents from selling real estate to mass-produced postcards, posters, and lithographs of weepy waifs, when he moved art from its gallery-based confines to telephone poles, tourist shops, and other populist marketplaces. Even Andy Warhol paid tribute. It didn't matter much whether critics hated the work and lampooned it as kitsch and sentimental trash if Joan Crawford, Natalie Wood, Kim Novak, Jerry Lewis, and Red Skelton would show theirs off with pride of ownership to syndicated newspapers and magazines. It required effort for Walter to party and pretend to care about hungry children with celebrities, businessmen, and hot young ones while introspective Margaret labored with a paintbrush at home. In his last days occupying a small cabin in La Jolla, Walter Keane could only reflect on how his behavior and claims drove away Margaret, his magic paycheck, to Hawaii, and complain of a sore arm when people asked him why he no longer painted his own big-eye art as displayed in those fancy art books. After the cover story appeared, Walter wrote an angry letter to the San Diego Reader accusing me of accepting six-figure largesse from Jehovah's Witness headquarters to play up Margaret as the true big-eye artist. If only.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.